When I started in Unreal Engine, there are three important things I wish I'd understood better. So big disclaimer, I'm not going to touch substrate. This is a beginner's overview about materials and concepts to do with that. So I'll leave it to another video. In fact, let's refresh the basics. Like, what are materials? Materials are basically little bits of code that get compiled or turned into little computer programs like tiny machines that live on the graphics card. And I want you to keep that kind of analogy in mind, the idea of a machine, because we'll come back to that later. So what's the simplest form of that machine in Unreal Engine? Let's make one. So we open up Unreal and we dive into the motion graphics template. Free download, link in description. And all I'm gonna do is come to the materials folder and basically just create a new material. I'm going to call it m_super_simple_material and double click on that. And there I have it open. So here you can see the base of the program that we're going to be making. This is like code that Unreal has already written, and we're gonna be adding our own code to this program. The first programming task is, how do we add a color? I'm just going to right click, type in 3V, and we see constant 3 vector. Now, in other programs, they would just have color or color vector or something like that. Like a lot of things in Unreal, it just has a different name to what you might be used to. So the constant is a 3 vector, and you can change that to whatever color you want. Plug it in, and boom, there's your first material. Click apply, save, and chuck it onto an object, and Bob's your uncle. Now, that's probably the fastest material you can make in Unreal Engine, but it's not really great. How do we figure out what a great material is? Well, for that, I'm just gonna take the old product design triangle of fast, cheap, good, and adapt it to our materials. I'd say that a great material is one that is fast to make, cheap to render, and looks great on screen. So our dinky little material, how does that fare? Well, it doesn't look great, but it was fast to make and it's cheap to render, right? Kind of. I mean, once you get into game land, think about all of these tiny little machines as taking up space. They take up resources. If you make a million of these materials, they are all gonna have to take up their own little bit of space. And to make them all, what was that, like 20 seconds? You know, you're gonna have to multiply that by as many materials as you need to make. So suddenly looking at that triangle, it's just not looking crash hot on any of the three points. This brings me to the first thing that I wish I knew more about when I started Unreal. That's the concept of the master material. Remember how I said that materials are like little programs that live on the graphics card, and how when you create a new material, you're adding code to that program? There's this amazing thing that we can do with this programming, and that's called instancing. Basically, instead of creating a whole new version of the material every single time, a whole new machine that has to take up space, you can create what's called an instance of that material, which is kind of like saying, instead of just using this identical machine, just use that first one. Kind of like creating a copy, except it doesn't take up any space, but they can still take in user inputs that are called variables. So you can feed it in a new color, and it'll be like you've created the new material, but without the overhead. To illustrate this, let's look at a sewing machine. A sewing machine is actually a very underrated piece of engineering. It takes simple circular motion and it creates really intricate results. Now, if you wanted to end up with a different stitch, you could just keep buying new sewing machines and each one would do a different stitch. Or you could buy a machine that accepts things called cams. Cams are weirdly shaped cogs, and what they do is they transform the simple circular motion into a different output. Same machine, same motion, different result. So, back in our super simple material, we could turn this color into a parameter. And the way we do that is we right click and type parameter, and you'll find the vector parameter. Confusingly, named differently to the constant 3 vector. We're gonna call it color. We're gonna plug that into the color instead. I'll give it a default of something pink and click apply and save. Now what we've done here, it's like having a machine, a bit of code, that accepts a cam. In this case, a parameter that accepts user data. After we've applied and saved, we can right click on our material and there is this option to create material instance. Now, once we've done that, you've now said to Unreal that this material is the master material or base machine, and in this material instance, I'm going to give you a different cam or modifier, and the master material will determine what the final result will be. Let's double click on the material instance to have a look. And we can already see it's a greatly simplified interface because you're not actually adding code. You're just changing the inputs. Now, if I tick on the color and give it a different value, we can see all of our materials have changed. So from here, all we would need to do is right click, create a new material instance and give it a different color. And so we could create all of the different colors that we need. And so everybody's happy, right? Yes, kind of. The thing is, if we had to make a million of these again and had to set the color on every single one, my RSI will start playing up again. I'll have to go see a doctor. It's not going to end well. Let's take this material creation just a step further, and we're going to add the second thing that beginners need to understand better about materials. That is proceduralism. Now, to be honest, this is something that Cinema 4D actually does really well. I kind of had already been making a lot of procedural materials before I came to Unreal Engine. But then I found out that a lot of people don't view materials this way. They see materials as basically a collection of textures that get put onto a model to make it look a certain way. Proceduralism is a different way of looking at things. It's just a fancy way of saying, instead of individual images being hand-placed on every 3D model, we'll be setting up a bunch of rules for figuring out what the materials look like. It's decentralizing the work and it makes it cheaper for everyone, but you still have an overall theme. So to show you what this looks like in Unreal, let's now, in our super simple material, we're gonna drop down a node called per instance random. Now, for every single instance of an object, this material will get a different random number between 0 and 1. Next to it, I'm gonna drop down a gradient map multi, which is just a little function, and we're going to plug our random number into the grayscale value to gradient map. I'm going to right click on the gradient texture pin and I'm going to click promote to parameter. I won't rename it because it's pretty well named already, but instead of the default texture, I'm going to click the down arrow. Inside search assets, I'm going to search for heat map, and there is a lovely rainbow we can plug in. Now, if I replace the base color with the output from this gradient map multi, click apply and click save. Now we can see that for every single instance, this random number is looking up a coordinate on this rainbow and giving that color to each instance. Now we're starting to see that triangle looking healthy. These materials are pretty fast to make, and when you duplicate them across millions of different objects, you can have variety that you can control with your rules, and the effort to make a million different shaders is pretty much the same as making one. However, it doesn't quite look great yet. Obviously, there's a lot of other things you can start to put in, but a lot of beginners struggle with how to make materials that really pop. And see, that's a step which seems out of reach for a lot of beginners. How do you go from just making extremely simple materials all the way through to complex systems? And then that's usually when they start looking into things called material libraries. Now, material libraries are often just used, but their true power is rarely unleashed. So when we talk about material libraries, the first thing people think of is Quixel Megascans. They are fantastic. They are built into the editor, they're gorgeous, and they're free for use within Unreal Engine. All you need to do is go to Window, click on Quixel Bridge, and you can immediately be browsing high quality surfaces, models, all of that kind of good stuff. With Quixel Megascans, their whole mission is around world building at an extremely photorealistic and optimized level. To get to that level, they hand author models and textures to work together. This means that Quixel is still built around the idea of textures that are placed on a specific 3D model in a specific UV space with the material instances that they have created built around manipulating those textures. So, coming back to us motion designers, where we are creating shapes from scratch and we're doing strange things and we don't like UVs, is there anything out there that allows us to have the benefits of a pre-built library? Maybe with like a more motion graphics kind of intent behind it? Like, of course the answer is yes. But the drawback is that it'll cost you money instead of time. There's the Greyscalegorilla Plus pack that just got announced to have Unreal support, but my favorite is this other new pack from the Pixel Lab. The Pixel Lab brought out this Unreal Materials pack, and at first I wondered, why would I want to use this instead of Quixel Megascans? Then I started to look through them and found a whole bunch more than I expected. See, this actually leads me to the third thing that I wish I'd done more of when I was starting in Unreal Engine. I really wish I had dug into other people's content examples to see how things are done. This is a superpower when it comes to learning, is once you start getting given high quality assets that you can basically pull apart, disconnect, reconnect things to see how they work, you will start to pick up things way faster. The reason that these are really good is that they're not just materials with textures plugged into, I guess, a kind of PBR style workflow. These are a group of materials that are intended to be more procedural in nature. And once you start pulling apart their master materials, you can see how they've achieved retroreflection, complex refraction, in both deferred and path tracing. So you've got a lot of bases covered just in this one pack. So instead of just using the material library to deliver great work to client, use these as a learning opportunity to be able to pull apart and see how people think. In the next video, we'll actually pull apart one of the master materials from this pack to see how it works, and then add our own brand of proceduralism to create our own version.